Good morning and welcome to the first meeting of the Education, Children and Young People 2022. This is a virtual meeting. The first item on our agenda today is an evidence session with the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills, part of our scrutiny of the Scottish Government budget for 2022 to 2023. So can I warmly welcome Shirley Ann Somerville, MSP, the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills, and her officials, Graeme Logan, Director of Learning, and Alison Cumming, Director of Early Learning and Childcare for the Scottish Government. Can I welcome all three of you to our meeting? And as is our custom, I would like to invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement, and then we will move on to questions. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Good morning again.
Thank you, and good morning, Convener. I want to take a few minutes just to make a short opening statement, and then, of course, very happy to take the committee's questions. Budget, as the committee will know, was introduced on the 9th of December, and at that time, the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Economy made clear that the budget cannot deliver the resources that all of our partners want. There are areas in government in which she and indeed the government as a whole would have wished to go further. However, without COVID funding, our day-to-day funding for 22-23 is significantly less this year. The SFC say that the Scottish Government's budget next year will be 2.6% lower than in 21-22, and that after accounting for inflation, that reduction is 5.2%. And this at a time when we undeniably need to invest in the economy and help public services recover, and despite the very real ongoing impacts of the pandemic. But we have allocated our resources in the best way that we can, seeking to deliver on key priorities. Turning to the education and skills portfolio, our priority is to ensure that all children and young people, whatever their background, grow up loved, safe and respected so that they reach their full potential. The overall portfolio budget has increased from £2,814.9 million in 21-22 to £2,927.1 million in 22-23, 4% in cash terms. The budget includes a record increased investment in teacher recruitment, the biggest increase to support teacher recruitment since 2007. We are providing funding for £145.5 million for teachers and classroom assistants, enough to employ 2,500 teachers and 500 support staff. This enables local authorities to employ permanently additional staff recruited through the pandemic. We're also delivering additional teacher training places, providing an additional £2.5 million for this. We provided £200 million for the Scottish Attainment Challenge, part of our commitment to provide £1 billion over the Parliament to tackle the poverty-related attainment gap and achieve the best possible outcomes for all our children and young people. Providing funding to reduce the costs of the school day, removing barriers to children in low incomes. This includes £11.8 million to maintain the school clothing grant at the increased levels introduced in August 21, £12 million to local government to continue to remove the charges for instrumental music tuition, and £8 million to local government to continue the removal of charges sometimes associated with core elements of the curriculum, such as art or home economics. We've allocated more than £72 million for the continued expansion of free school meals. This provides lunches for all children in primaries 1 to 5 and in special schools, and supporting the infrastructure required to roll out lunches to all primary school children. We'll invest £22 million to provide meals during school holidays to the children who need it most. Funding is also being provided to maintain the subsidy arrangements for the provision of milk. My officials will be working with partners to develop a phased approach to the delivery of a universal milk system aligned to the expansion of free school meals. £50 million in this budget supports the development of the infrastructure required to provide a device to every school-aged child, and we've provided a further £5 million to tackle digital inclusion in colleges, universities and the community learning and development sectors. The budget includes £544 million for the delivery of free funded early learning and childcare for 3- and 4-year-olds and for 2-year-olds from lower-income households. We're also investing £10 million in holiday childcare for low-income families and £3 million in early phasing of wraparound childcare. We're providing a further £5 million to renew play parks in Scotland as part of the £60 million programme over the course of this Parliament to ensure children have access to high-quality outdoor play. As part of our commitment to keep the promise, an initial £50 million has been provided to establish a whole family wellbeing fund, which will provide person-centred holistic support for children and families. The budget for this next year maintains college resource funding at £675.7 million. Capital funding for colleges has increased by £41 million. Universities resource funding has increased by £21 million to £789.2 million to meet the cost for ongoing support for the additional places previously added for those affected by the SQA alternative certification model. Scotland has a moral imperative to address the wrongs of the past, recognising that nothing can ever make up for the suffering of survivors of historic child abuse have endured. So £41 million has been provided to make payments under the statutory redress scheme in 22-23, an increase of £31 million from this year. Improving the life chances of our children, young people and our learners of all ages through excellence and equity in education continues to be a key priority for this government and for this portfolio to deliver on. I'm of course happy to take questions from the committee this morning, convener.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you for your opening statement. You'll recall that we wrote to you as a committee on the 10th of November as pre-budget scrutiny. And basically the committee agreed, having heard the evidence, that setting outcomes and clearly explaining how success will be measured is critical to assessing the effectiveness of any intervention. The committee is therefore always keen to find out more information on outcomes from the government. Are you aligned to the reasoning of the committee around measuring outcomes rather than inputs, measuring the outputs that come from the expense that you just described?
I think this is a very important point, convener, and I'd be very interested as this session develops to hear more from the committee on this. I could perhaps give a couple of examples about where we are moving forward on this. One, of course, is the National Improvement Framework, where we are determined to ensure that the spending within the education and skills portfolio really does directly have an impact on the National Improvement Framework and the work from that. And that is all about improving outcomes for children and young people. The latest version of that was, of course, published in December of this year. So that is one example of the type of work that we do in that. The other area I would point to is the work on the Scottish Attainment Challenge. We recognise that that £1 billion worth of expenditure that's coming in during this parliamentary session, it's integral that we know that the money is being spent in the most effective fashion. That's exactly why part of the announcement that I made to Parliament on that was work that we will do with local authorities around stretch aims so that we know what the money is being spent on and, importantly, what schools and local authorities think that will deliver. Now, of course, once we have that information, working very closely with local authorities, Education Scotland can ensure that they are therefore supporting local authorities to be able to deliver those outcomes. And then we can, of course, see what is happening against those outcomes. So I give those as two examples, convener, because I think it is a very fair point that the committee raises and something which I'm very keen to see what we can do further work on.
Well, it's not just something that the committee has plucked out of the air, as you will appreciate, Cabinet Secretary. I mean, Audit Scotland have been very direct in their recommendations to the government, not just in this area of public policy, but in many other public areas of public policy, that it's very important that we set out in advance what we expect to have happen in beneficial terms because of the money that is committed on behalf of the Scottish taxpayer. And I take it you agree with that?
Yes, I do. And again, the aspects around the attainment challenge funding is specifically in relation to some of the responses from Audit Scotland in the work that they looked at from the first phase of it. So we absolutely took that on board. I've listened very carefully to that as we went through the refresh of SAC 0.2.
Right, thank you for that. So you tweeted on the 18th of August last year, £80 million of COVID recovery funding to be made permanent, allowing councils to further to offer further permanent contracts to teachers. This is in addition to the £65.5 million funding announced last week for 1,000 additional teachers as part of our 100 days commitment. So can I ask you, on the basis that just a few days before that tweet, you gave me an answer to a parliamentary question that confirmed that 12% of all of Scotland's teachers were on temporary contracts. Can I begin by asking you then, on the basis of your tweet and other comments that have been made in Parliament and elsewhere, do you know how many teachers are on temporary contracts as of today?
Well, these figures are updated regularly, but not on a real times basis. So what we do know, for example, from the teacher census is that we have 2,000 additional teachers overall. That's an important recognition of the funding that's going in. What we do still need to see, and it's not showing up in a teacher census yet because of the timing of when that census is done, is the move from temporary to permanent contracts. And that's something which we will see moving forward in future future figures which come out from the teacher census. But certainly the clear direction from government and encouragement from government is that this funding is now being made permanent. We were hearing from local authorities that one of the reasons why the number of teachers on temporary contracts was as high as it was because of a temporary funding. We've now taken that challenge away from local authorities. They are the recruiters of teachers, not government, not national government. But absolutely, we will have we will be able to encourage local authorities to ensure that they're changing those temporary contracts to permanent contracts now that the funding's in. But that, of course, won't show up in the latest teacher census just because of the timing.
Sorry to interrupt you, Councillor. So are you saying that you don't know whether or not that money has been used thus far to make temporary contracts permanent contracts? Is that what I think you're saying?
Well, it's a bit early. It's a bit early to be able to determine the impact that this has made, but we are keeping a very close eye on this. And when the figures have been updated through teacher census, then we will be able to determine that is happening. Certainly, that's the clear wish that's came from government, the encouragement that's came from government, and I think, to be fair, local authorities are picking up on that, but the figures for that won't show up until the next teacher census.
Yeah, in an earlier evidence session, I asked COSLA this question, as well as one of the teaching unions, and they were equally unsure about what's happening to that money. So let me ask you a different question, in the spirit of what I started out to talk about this morning about outcomes. What would success look like in terms of an outcome for you as the Cabinet Secretary for Education in terms of the spending of that additional £80 million? What is success going to look like? What is the number of temporary contracts as a percentage of the total teaching faculty, if you like, of the country? What should that look like when we get that result that you are looking towards?
Well, what we've made a commitment to is that funding can allow local authorities to be able to deliver on permanent contracts. So, for example, we know to an approximate level how many teachers that will be able to be able to recruit. So, for example, the £145.5 million that's in the budget is enough to employ 2,500 teachers, 500 support staff. So what we will be looking at is the change in numbers of staff, given how much we know that money will be able to pay for. Now, some local authorities may choose to spend more on permanent support staff rather than permanent teachers. That's a local choice that they will be able to take depending on what they think is right for their area. There may be some change to that given local circumstances, but we're certainly analysing it on the basis of how much money is going in, how much that funding should be able to provide teachers and support staff, and we'll measure on that basis.
So can I press you on that? Because again, that's all good, but what numbers are we looking at? What percentage are you looking at? It's currently 12%. That's 1 in 8 of all Scotland's teachers. What is the success that you're looking for in terms of a reduction? I presume we agree we want a reduction in that number.
Yep.
How far down can you get that number for the 80 million?
Kinvir, you've certainly frozen on my screen. I don't know whether the problem is at my end or at committee's end. Don't know if anyone else on the committee can hear me, but I certainly have lost the convener.
Well, he seems to have frozen, as far as I can see,
okay.
Cabinet Secretary.
In the absence of the convener, as the vice convener, good morning, Leanne Somerville, I will take over. So if you could continue with your answer there.
Certainly. So as I was trying to put to the convener, we've got more teachers now than we have since 2008. We've seen that addition in the teacher census that's came out. We know how much funding we've put in, so it's the 145.5 million. We know how many teachers that should employ. So, for example, as I said, 2,500 teachers, 500 support staff. So that's what I am looking for to see a change in. Now, as I did reiterate to the convener, there may be changes to that because local authorities may decide to vary between teachers and support staff. So we can't put an exact figure on it because we are not dictating to local authorities how that money should be spent. I think quite rightly it's up to local authorities to determine local needs. But certainly that's the aspect that I'm looking on, is I know the funding that's came in, that's went in, I know what that funding can be able to produce, and we will be keeping a close eye on the figures to ensure that that's actually what that funding delivers.
But you referred to the teachers' census. Do we have an idea of when the next teachers' census will be coming out at all? Just so that, you know, we can sort of like compare the figures in between the last census and the next one, and then that gives us sort of like tangible results. And also, I just wanted to refer, you know, I remember sort of like when I was teaching as well, and obviously there are a certain percentage of teachers that do prefer to remain on temporary contracts for one reason or another. So I think it's important to sort of put that on record, that not every single teacher will want to be on a permanent contract. Also, I was wanting to ask about supply teachers, and that has been mentioned to me a few times within the profession, especially regarding support of staff absences and things that inevitably, you know, with the COVID context, we're dealing with. So any sort of comments around the use of supply teachers as well would be helpful. Thank you.
Thanks. So in relation to the census, it is annual and it comes out in December. We've not long had that. So what we do have to do in the interim period is rely on our, of course, ongoing discussions with local authorities on these matters. But the official teacher census is published every December for this. We will, as I say, monitor that very, very closely in the interim with local authorities, but that won't be official statistics until that point. The issue of supply staff is key, and it ties into to the point you make yourself around the fact that although there are teachers that are on temporary contracts that would wish to be into permanent employment, and that's what we want to see as a government. That's why I've made that funding available. There are some people who do wish to be on a temporary contract and want to work in that way. So we'll never change that entirely, because some of the workforce do want to be flexible. What's key is that we can do everything we can to encourage permanent contracts with local authorities where at all possible. But the number of supply staff, of course, is exceptionally important to allow for a flexible workforce, particularly at this time. We have, I should say, as well, to committee, let committee be aware that earlier on in the pandemic, we did, of course, put a call out via the General Teaching Council for Scotland for retired teachers if they wanted to come back into the profession for some time. The uptake on that, I have to say, was exceptionally low. Very small number came forward from that. I understand that that has been similar in other countries which have tried that type of method of approach as well. But it is something which we are looking to do again to see whether any difference could be made. I would say at the outset we would again expect the numbers on that to be low, as with other countries, but we certainly think it's something which should be approached.
Thank you, Minister. Can I just bring in Bob Doris on this issue for a brief supplementary?
Thank you, Deputy Convener. Previously explored the line of questioning that the Convener, Mr Kerr, had been exploring at previous sessions with COSLA. Just for clarity, is the additional monies that are now baselined into next year's budget, is that ring-fenced? And if it's not contradictory, is it ring-fenced with a degree of flexibility? So there must be the creation of permanent contracts, but the balance between classroom assistants and teachers is up to each local authority to decide what best meets local needs. And that I would get. But also, whether it's a teacher census or otherwise, what is the reporting exercise on that? Because if we increase the amount of teachers, then that could involve not a significant fall in the amount of temporary teachers, because temporary teachers could be converted to permanent posts and new teachers could come in for specific projects on a temporary basis, and that wouldn't tell the whole story. So are we going to get a consistent reporting exercise across 32 local authorities to better understand what's happening with teachers and classroom assistants in Scotland? If the teacher census can do that, great, but if it can't, can the Scottish Government do something else so our committee could see, look in a few months' time, to see what progress there's been with our ongoing budget scrutiny?
I certainly think it is something that the teacher census can look at, but very conscious that just as the government is looking to ensure that this money delivers over this year, then obviously the committee will have a key interest in that as well. We don't dictate to local authorities how that money should be spent, because I think it is very important that local authorities are the recruiters of educational staff. They will be able to determine what is best in their local area. So we are not providing the funding on the basis of it must be on a certain percentage of teachers and a certain percentage of support staff. I think that would be absolutely the wrong message to send out to local authorities. And we're very keen to ensure that that is delivered locally by them. The one thing I would say is we have to obviously be very careful to not overburden local authorities on reporting for this, but of course we do keep very close contact with councils and with COSLA right across the year to be able to determine what is happening. Numbers are of course very fluid, they will change depending on what's happening on a week-to-week basis within local authorities, so this isn't a static exercise, but it is something that we will ensure that we will continue to keep a close eye on, and we will of course keep the committee updated in any way that I can on that.
Thank you, Minister. I believe that the convener is now back online, so I would like to hand back over to the convener.
Hi, the COCAB, thank you so much for stepping in. I apologise to everybody. My computer just decided to shut down. Suddenly just shut down, but there we go. Maybe he didn't like my line of questioning, I don't know, but that's what happens. Cabinet Secretary, if I may ask you a couple of other quick questions with some just quick responses from yourself, it's absolutely fine to be brief. How would you rate teacher morale in schools today?
I think this has been shown very recently in, for example, the EIS survey, which came out that this has been an exceptionally difficult time for not just teachers, but other staff within our schools as well. This is a very, very difficult time for everyone as we go through the pandemic, but the ability for teachers to have to adapt very quickly to what has been happening has been exceptionally difficult, and I would absolutely pay credit to them. That's why we've taken teacher wellbeing very, very seriously during this. We've invested money in this in the past, £2 million, and we'll continue to make sure that there's support from Education Scotland from them, because we do recognise it's a very difficult time for teachers.
So you are concerned about teacher morale, clearly, and teacher wellbeing.
I'm always concerned about teacher wellbeing, but particularly, I think, during a pandemic, there is a responsibility on government to be able to take that seriously.
And teacher morale as well, yeah?
Yeah.
And the Scottish Government created this, put in place a scheme, a partnership with Place to Be since September to support teachers' mental health. What's been the uptake of that scheme, and how would you rate the performance so far, and what do you expect it to deliver in terms of an outcome?
Well, I don't have the figures for the uptake on that, but happy to provide that to committee. Certainly, the material that I've seen that's came back in terms of feedback has been that it's been widely welcomed, and that teachers have found these types of schemes useful. There's been a number of aspects that Education Scotland have also delivered their own around teacher wellbeing, and that's very, very important that we look at these things in the round on these aspects. But certainly the feedback that I've had has that they have been well received, well used, but the figures, the exact figures, I don't have to hand, and we can supply to the committee.
If you can bring us up to speed on the uptake on that, that would be very useful. And just very quickly, you said, and maybe other colleagues will pick this up later, but you said in the chamber in December that the reduction of contact hours, chalk face, some people call it, hours by 90 minutes would happen in the next academic year. That's from this August. How is that going? What's been the outcome of your negotiations with the Scottish Negotiating Committee for Teachers? And do you expect to be able to realise this very important, in the light of the OECD study in particular, this very important target that you have created for yourself?
Well, that's certainly what we would like to be able to deliver, and I think it's important that government sets itself a very, very challenging target because we want to be able to deliver that. Now, this isn't something which government can deliver. It's something for the SNCT to look at. We need to look at the planning and the modelling for that. So if we were to go ahead, as government would wish in August, what does that mean? Can it be delivered? We may have to move forward, for example, on a phased basis. Would that be something that would perhaps assist the system easier? We would certainly be keen to move forward with it from August from a government perspective. But of course, what we need to absolutely look at is the planning and the modelling to see whether that is feasible right across the education system. So that's detailed.
Yeah, it's an aspiration more than a commitment then, yeah?
Well, it's not for the Scottish Government to be able to deliver on. We need to work with local authorities and the trade unions. So we would like to move forward with this quickly. So would the trade unions, for example. But our wish to be able to deliver on that has to come onto the brass tacks of the planning and the modelling about whether it can be achieved. So we're certainly pushing towards that. That will have, for example, very different implications for different local authorities, different sizes of schools, whether it's primary, secondary, for example. So looking at all those very, very fine details, we need to get into that.
I think that's people will be concerned. Just to conclude, people will be concerned by the response you've given to my last couple of questions on contact time, because your words in the chamber on the 14th of December were very clear. Our commitment to reduce class contact time for teachers by 90 minutes per week. It was a commitment. You're making a commitment, and it seems to me now you sound like you're stepping back from the commitment, and it's now, well, it's someone else that's going to have to deliver it. That's how it's coming across to me Is that how you mean to come across?
Well, we are committed to driving this forward. You know, the government would like to see this happening in August, but the government can't make it happen. So absolutely, from the government's perspective, we are absolutely committed to doing everything that we can from our side to be able to make this happen. But it's not just up to government. So we absolutely have the willingness of government to do this. I know partners will be looking at this very, very carefully too, in local authorities and trade unions. There is a willingness to make this happen. There is an absolute commitment from government to be able to do everything that we can to make it happen. But we do, of course, have to look at the very, very fine detail of how we make that happen in every single school, looking at the different sizes and the different sizes of local authorities. But we will start by then if we at all possibly can.
And all the costs to this reduction of contact time will be met by the Scottish Government, yes?
Yes, that's in many ways one of our determinations to drive forward teacher numbers so quickly, is to ensure that we can move forward with class contact time.
I thank you so much for answering my questions. I think I've taken more than the time I should have because of all the hijinks with the tech, but I'm going to turn to my deputy convener and colleague, Kocab. Do you wish to come back in, Kocab Stewart?
Thank you, convener. Actually, while you were offline, I was able to ask my questions also on teacher recruitment and numbers. So if it's okay with everyone, I can just move on to my line of questioning,
yes.
Which actually the previous thread, I can pick up on that quite nicely, regarding sort of policy agendas and commitments and priorities being set at government level. And then the responsibility of delivering that obviously lies at local government level. So with that responsibility that local governments have, there is a balance to be considered regarding having ring-fenced money for specifics and also discretionary funding. So I'd like to explore the strengths and weaknesses of each method of distribution and how the government is how the government has assessed the strengths and weaknesses of either ring fencing, but also providing discretionary funding.
So I suppose the key strength of providing specific funding for specific purposes is to ensure that all the money that's being provided for that particular purpose will go to that particular purpose. Now, one of the examples of that I would point to would be the expansion to the 1140 hours for early learning and childcare. So this has very much been shared priorities between Scottish Government and local government for these types of projects. So it's allowed the Scottish Government to be able to move forward with that commitment to provide that via local authorities. I do appreciate that the ring-fenced funding does reduce local authority discretion in some of these areas, but I think it's worth noting that although ring-fenced funding is for increased investment in services such as schools and nurseries, 93% of the funding we'll provide is not formally ring-fenced from that. We do recognise there's a call from local government to move to less ring funding, and I understand the Cabinet Secretary for Finance has committed to reviewing all ring-fenced funding as part of the resource spending review, and we'll continue our constructive engagement with local government as part of that through our education areas that are ring-fenced.
I take your point about the fact that ring-fenced money does allow sort of like a specific route to ensure sort of like policy delivery from government level. However, you know, we're all aware that local needs and priorities can vary across the country within local authorities. And I've had sort of like several questions put to me about the consistency of delivery across all local authorities. So what is, or is there a role, I would imagine that there is a pretty strong role of government in ensuring that consistency across all local authorities across Scotland. What is the role of government in that to ensure that consistency? And has there been any work done on monitoring and assessing the consistency of delivery?
Well, I think you raise a very important point in these areas. And I think as we have funding which leaves national government and moves to local government, it is absolutely for local government to determine how that money is spent if it's outside ring-fenced budgets. I think it's very important that we all keep a close regard on the variation which happens within education, and that's variation of outcomes. And it's the variation of outcomes, I think, which should be a shared concern for all of us. The variation of how things are done in an educational basis is absolutely to be encouraged, because we should not have a one-size-fits-all policy coming from Edinburgh, but a variation in outcomes for children is something which we are determined to look at. And I would point to some of the key aspects within the Scottish Attainment Challenge funding, which I raised with the convener earlier, that we're determined to move forward with, that looks specifically at variation. In other areas, of course, we will, of course, set outcome frameworks for what we expect for these programmes. So for 1140 hours, there's outcome frameworks so that there's an understanding of what is delivered for the funding that goes in. So I think both for ring fence funding in terms of outcome frameworks, but also just an awareness of what is happening with the funding that leaves national government and goes to local government, so that we know what the outcomes of that funding are, I think is important, not just for the Scottish government, but obviously for local authorities as well.
Thank you for that, Minister. I'd like to hand back to the convener. Thank you.
Thank you, Colcab Stewart. I turn now to Ross Greer.
Thank you, convener. I'd like to stick with the previous line of questioning around teacher recruitment, teacher numbers. The £145 million that was announced as part of the budget, the Cabinet Secretary mentioned in her opening statement, that's the largest single increase for teacher recruitment since 2007. But I'd like to drill down into the detail of that. Subsequent to the publication of the budget, that number was subject to some negotiation with COSLA, as is normal. They'd be the ones deploying the fund. So my understanding is the £145 million breaks down, obviously, 32 local authorities, but it's broken down into what are essentially five funding streams. So the five that I've got listed are funding for teachers, primary teaching staff, secondary teaching staff, special schools, and teacher pay. I was just wondering if the Cabinet Secretary could, in the first instance, explain to me what the distinction is between funding for teachers and the three streams broken down by primary, secondary, and special school. It appears that the funding for teachers is the largest single amount. So if I take Aberdeen City as the first on the list that I can see, there's £2.6 million for Aberdeen City funding for teachers. But then there's £800,000 primary teaching staff, £900,000 secondary teaching staff, £240,000 special school. What are those three additional columns, or if they are separate to this funding for teachers stream?
Well, you raise a very, very important point around how this money goes out to local authorities, and then the discretion for local authorities to be able to move this forward. So, yes, the money will go to from Scottish Government to the local government to allow them to make the decisions that they're wishing to make within those funding streams that we put out. I don't know whether Alison or Graham may wish to come in on this to describe some more of the detail on it.
I think Graham Wogan's looking to
Sorry, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you, Mr. Greer.
Yes, clearly there is some discretion for local government because we want them to use the funding for additional teachers to meet their needs locally. And for example, you know, in terms of additional support for learning, given you know the figures on pupils with additional support needs, you know, every teacher now is supporting children with additional support needs in mainstream. So we really want to provide as much flexibility, you know, across primary, secondary, and special to meet local needs, and that can be challenging, of course, in different geographical areas where there might be different shortages in terms of particular subjects or specialisms. But there is, you know, a lot of flexibility there in terms of how the funding is used to employ the teachers that are needed locally. And also in our workforce planning, we look at this quite carefully. So that, for example, we don't end up with too many primary teachers and not enough of other types of teachers as well.
Thanks. That was a useful clarification of the purpose of those additional three columns. In that case, I've just got one other technical question around the fifth part of this stream, which is teacher pay. So again, to just use Aberdeen City as an example, because it's the first on the spreadsheet that I can see, there's £200,000 allocated for teacher pay as part of Aberdeen City's allocation of the overall £145 million. What exactly does that mean by teacher pay? Because I'm presuming the overwhelming majority of what the money in the other four columns is going to be spent on is teacher pay. There's a small amount that will go on the admin, payroll, etc. But this is £145 million is overwhelmingly going to be spent on paying additional teachers. So what's the purpose of this specific allocation within that of teacher pay?
There's not a specific allocation within the overall Scottish Government's budget for teachers' pay, because as Mr Greer rightly points out, the teacher recruitment is in effect the teacher pay. That's what it goes on. Committee will, of course, be aware that we're still going through a process of seeking an agreement on teachers' pay for this financial year. Committee will be aware that an offer was made by COSLA, which is currently with trade union members, for discussion and decision on. So, with the committee's forbearance, I'm not going to say too much on the current teachers' pay because clearly we're still in the middle of a process. But that, what I will say is that process has gone on for an exceptionally long time. I completely appreciate that teachers are very frustrated about how long that is taking, but we do need to come to an agreement on the teachers' pay, and that will need to work its way through the SNCT as per the usual process on that. And certainly the Scottish Government stands by to make any changes it can to allow that to move forward. But clearly the government has already put in additional funding to the overall local government settlement, which assisted with the wider local government workforce on this. So I think that's a demonstration of how we have played our part in moving things forward, and it's now a position which must run its course through the SNCT.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Just one final question on this issue. You've just been in discussion there with the convener around the government's commitment to reducing teacher contact time, etc. What is the relationship between this additional funding for teacher recruitment and the objective of reducing class contact time and getting that better balance for the workload of the existing teaching workforce?
Well, clearly teacher recruitment is absolutely integral to the opportunity for the partners to be able to move forward with the reduction in class contact time. That's exactly why the government has invested so heavily in this. We are aware that there are practical challenges of bringing this in, you know, timetabling, you know, being one of those, and we're aware that schools continue to be under pressure because of dealing with COVID currently as well. So we know there's a lot of pressure on the system, but we know one of the ways that we can assist with that, if we at all possibly can, is a reduction in class contact time for teachers to be able to go back to another point we discussed earlier, which was around staff welfare.
Thanks very much. I think I've probably taken up enough time, Convener. I'd be keen to come back in later on the costs of COVID, but there'll be other members wishing to come in before you come back to me, I'm sure.
Thank you, Roscoe. Yes, absolutely. Try and get you back in when you indicate. I turn now to Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, Convener. Couple of different questions. One around free school meals and another around qualitative data. Free school meals, delighted with the £72 million investment and the £22 million for school holiday clubs as well. Although it is a bit concerning as well to hear that there's an expected 5.2% real terms reduction next year. I trust these will be things that will be prioritised. Now, just looking at the school holiday money there as well, we know that part of the thinking behind free school meals for primary children is the fact that it increases uptake amongst our most vulnerable children, that reduces the stigma there. So really just as a point of clarity, and I know certainly North and South Lanarkshire Council have approached this differently. North Lanarkshire Council are only doing their holiday lunchtime clubs for the children who currently get free school meals, whereas South Lanarkshire Councils are open to everyone. So it was really just for a bit of clarity around the funding there for the school holidays. Is that expected to cover all children, or is it very specifically about vulnerable children? Thank you.
The aspects around the funding and, in general, the support we can provide to young people during the school holidays has been an important development as we've approached COVID, and something which we are, of course, keen to move further with as we eventually see the back of COVID. The entitlement is for those with free school meals, and it is targeted, but that is a minimum, and we do know that some local authorities will have gone and will go further on this. I think we can ensure that we are delivering a project which works for families on low incomes to be able to really reach out to a diverse range of children, particularly, of course, looking at children with disabilities, additional support needs, children from BME backgrounds, etc. So while there is that focus and target on free school meals, we're very, very conscious of not looking at that as one group, but what can be done within that funding to make sure that we are supporting children and young people from different backgrounds to ensure that that's going as wide as it can within that entitlement.
It would certainly be quite interesting then to see if maybe a bit of work could be undertaken to look at the local authorities that have gone a bit further, and whether or not there's a hugely increased demand there. Moving on to my second question, though, certainly it's good to see in your letter responding to a convener's letter as well there about you know, respecting the need for a stronger national and local data across all the four capacities for curriculum for excellence there, and that there's going to be the short life subgroup of the Curriculum and Assessment Board to explore the options for a sample-based survey. Really interested in the qualitative data stuff, because that's something that's coming up really often across lots of the different strands that we're looking at there. And I was wondering if you're kind of able to expand on that anymore, or say something around the idea that, you know, that's something that will run a bit wider than just looking at the curriculum for excellence stuff just now. Thanks.
So we are very keen to make sure we are gathering the correct data. I think in many ways this points back to some of the initial points that the convener was making at the start about making sure that we are gathering the correct data so we know what the outcomes are from the educational spend that goes in. The short life working group that we have is in response to the OECD recommendations which came out, which very much said that we needed to see what more could be done to look at the other three capacities within Curriculum for Excellence, which we don't currently have the same level of data at. Of course, we do have a wide range of other surveys which paint a picture of young people's progress, the health and wellbeing survey being one of those. I'm sure this is something which the committee will come back to at some point in the future, and we'd of course I'll be happy to provide the committee with an update on the work that's happening around data, that short life working group, and where that's going once we've reached a point where decisions, recommendations have been made from that.
And just around the idea of the kind of wider focus and the qualitative data as well in education, is that something that you're going to be looking at?
Well, we do have a wide range of surveys which go out. As I say, the health and wellbeing survey is one of those. We of course are keen to look at the data that we look at in general to make sure it's providing the information that we think we require, and that's why we have a short life working group to look at these aspects. We've also got, for example, the Growing Up in Scotland survey, which looks at, I think, some of the types of data which the member is speaking about. So hopefully that gives a reassurance that we're keen to ensure we're gathering the right data in the right way to be able to determine the impacts that not just education policies, but other policies and society in general are having on children and youth.
That's great. That's really helpful. Thank you. Convener?
Thank you, Stephanie Callaghan. Turn now to Michael Mara.
Thank you, Convener. Useful to follow on some of those issues of data, Cabinet Secretary. I mean, the only data that we have so far regarding the impact of the pandemic on attainment and on school achievement is the deeply concerning figures that came out regarding the primary school levels. Attainment at its lowest level, the gap between the poorest of kids and the rest at the highest ever level. I mean, those are concerns that you would share, aren't they?
Exceptionally concerning. As I said at the time, this is something which we are seeing right across the UK and indeed further afield as we see the impact of COVID, but they are a concerning set of statistics.
Can I ask him, when did you have sight of these results? They were published on the 14th of December. Am I right in assuming that they were trailed, I think, in little kind of snippets and different speeches and announcements that you were expecting the data to be very concerning for us all? So when did you first have sight of those results?
Very close to publication, given their official statistics, but I don't think it took me to see the statistics to know that they were going to be poor. I think the fact that we had the equity audit many, many months before that were pointing in the direction of travel, that these were going to be bad statistics. So given their official statistics, they would have went through that process of me not seeing them until very close to publication. But see, I didn't really need to wait for the statistics to know the direction of travel we're going to go in.
Yeah, and I think there's a broad logic to that. You've mentioned obviously the kind of the international experience of that and the lost learning that's taken place. I can understand that. So the budget was published on the 9th of December. Could you tell us, given the concern, the long-term concern that you had, in some detail, what representations you made to the Cabinet Secretary for Finance to deal with that impact, deal with the impact of attainment on what had happened in our schools, the absence of learning? What were the resources you were asking for, the initiatives that you were putting in place? So what was the argument you were making to colleagues to make sure that we could deal with this impact?
Well, clearly we had set out the direction of travel and the COVID recovery before the budget came out, because we did recognise there was going to be a very big challenge in this area. That's exactly why we made the commitment to the £1 billion for the Scottish Attainment Challenge funding. That's why the commitment was made pre-budget to make permanent and therefore baseline the funding for teacher recruitment. So, given we knew that there was going to be a difficult time for children and young people, what we put in train in terms of COVID recovery for the money for the Scottish Attainment Challenge funding and teacher recruitment is the way that this was dealt with, and obviously that was funded through the budget process. That's of course on top of the £500 million for COVID response and recovery that we had already put in place as the pandemic had had begun.
So the site or the emerging evidence of the scale of this impact didn't really make much difference in terms of the approach that you'd taken to, you know, the COVID recovery plan, as has been well recognised by both your colleagues and trade unions, is a repackaging of previous announcements. The you know, the PEF funding, Attainment Challenge funding, a £20 million cut on that, of course, but the same amounts of money across each number of years. Do you not think the scale of this challenge requires something that's of a different proportion to what you were actually doing 3 years ago?
Well, what we've put in is an increase on the Scottish Attainment Challenge from £750 million in the previous Parliament to £1 billion. And what,
if I can, only because this is an extra year, so it's only spread across another year. There's no more money per year than it was in the previous Parliament.
I think it's a substantial investment into children's education to have expenditure on it. What was in last year's budget, or this financial year's budget, was of course a £20 million a COVID premium. But given the fact that the Scottish Government overall hasn't actually seen any COVID consequentials coming to it this year, it has been exceptionally difficult to move forward with further progress on this in terms of specific COVID premiums. What we have seen, and again I pointed to this in my opening remarks, was the biggest investment for many years in teacher recruitment. That is absolutely a recognition of the challenges that education was and was about to face, and that's exactly why we have put in the massive investment that we have into teacher recruitment, because we knew this was going to be a challenging thing.
But if, Cabinet Secretary, that investment, as you already acknowledged in the committee today, will take us back to 2008 levels. If we can get to that number, so actually not even as high as the situation that your government took on in 2007, but the scale of this challenge that we face now is the highest we have ever faced. You know, these statistics and very limited statistical evidence so far. I would like to see an awful lot more. I have to say, and we've called for that time and again. A real good focus today on the evidence, but actually there's a question that I have in this about how proportionate your response has been to the scale of the challenge. I mean, it doesn't sound to me that in those discussions with the Cabinet Secretary that you've managed to make or win the argument for more resource or for a disproportionate or a proportionate response to the scale of this challenge. Would that be fair? I mean, this is a repetition of previous plans that don't really take into account the scale of the challenge that we face.
Well, I don't think it would be fair to say that the level of funding that we're putting into teacher recruitment, which is the biggest increase in funding to support teacher recruitment since 2007, is a rehash of what we were doing already. That's a substantial investment and change from last year. But I would point to the fact that
you're only making good on the cuts that you have made since 2007. There's no overall increase in teacher numbers. Even if we get to that more welcome position, and I do welcome that funding, and that's the getting back to that position. But these are cuts that your government have made.
Well, what we have seen within the last teacher census is an additional 2,000 teachers. We have, of course, got the commitment that we will deliver on and are delivering on to provide 3,500 additional teachers, 500 support staff over this parliamentary term. I would point to the fact that a recent Institute of Fiscal Studies report highlighted for the past 13 years, Scotland has had the highest spend per pupil of the four UK nations. and that we now have a pupil-teacher ratio at its best level since 2009. So I think we are at a stage where we have put significant investment in, both to deal with the challenges of the pandemic of the £0.5 billion expenditure, which I mentioned earlier, and the work that we're doing on attainment funding and the work we're doing on teacher recruitment and in other areas, that shows our determination to take this very seriously.
Convener, if I can just close on this area with a question about the evidence, if that's okay. I mean, these statistics, as you've acknowledged, Cabinet Secretary, very concerning for all of us, you know, exceptionally concerning in your own words. I think it's really important that we get more evidence about the impact of the pandemic. Can you tell us what research you might have commissioned to inform your policy and your decisions about the recovery in education, particularly relating to secondary schools, which you'll acknowledge that there's been a perhaps, in your view, an understandable gap in terms of the lack of data. But what else can this committee expect to see and have made available to us about the impact of the pandemic in terms of structural research?
Well, of course, we had the equity audit, which the government published. We have exceptionally regular discussions at the at CERG, the Education Recovery Group, to look at this. I would point to the National Improvement Framework report in December, which included evidence as well. And clearly there were some gaps in what could be collated as part of the NIF because of the impact of COVID. But that's certainly one of the key areas where we will also be able to see the impact of it. We keep in regular discussions as well on an international basis with our Council of Education advisors to be able to learn what we can from that. And I have regular contact with my teachers panel and also the Scottish Education Council to ensure that in the interim periods between official statistics being delivered or NIFs being published, that we are in regular discussions with stakeholders about the impact on these issues.
So nothing new commissioned to make good on that gap, particularly in secondary school? No.
Well, the reason that the material wasn't collated as part of the NIF was that it was not possible to be able to do that during the period where we had COVID. So I think very, very carefully, we need to look at what schools can publish, given the implications of COVID for them. So I think, I hope the committee would appreciate there was understandable reasons why some of the material couldn't be delivered. But we, of course, again, have the material that's being looked at from our stakeholders for this, and the material which, of course, comes from the SQA in terms of secondary schools.
Okay, thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Michael Mara. Turning now to James Dornan.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, Cabinet Secretary. I'd like to ask you about... Oh, my apologies. Sorry, Cabinet Secretary. I'd like to ask you a wee bit about the multi-year funding for further and higher education. I'm looking forward to it, as I'm sure most education stakeholders are, to the announcement you're going to make in May regarding the multi-year funding plans. But how can you assure that these packages, whatever they may be, will support the colleges and universities in addressing the long-term financial sustainability challenges, such as rising staff and pension costs?
Well, we've looked very carefully at the calls from further and higher education for multi-year funding packages. I am very sympathetic to that on the basis that it allows for better planning, and that's certainly something which I have the greatest sympathy for them with. It obviously it's been something which is challenging for government to do when we don't ourselves have a multi-year budget that comes to the Scottish Government. So that does present us with challenges on these aspects. So this will be taken forward as you've said, Mr. Doran, as part of the work the Cabinet Secretary for Finance is looking at in terms of what can be done in terms of further multi-year funding. I would point to the Scottish Funding Council review, which also highlighted the importance of this, and this is something that we're very keen to take early action on in terms of the Funding Council review overall, to see what else can be done to support the sector. In terms of what will happen from now on, we know that there are aspects that governments shouldn't think intervene on. I would point to example for industrial relations within these sectors. I think obviously as universities are autonomous bodies, that is certainly something which should be left to the sector, to universities. And again, with colleges, I think it's important that the role of colleges and the trade unions is allowed to play out and ensure that there's a kind of a positive working relationship with colleges and universities on this. But clearly, the spending review does give us the opportunity to look at the higher and further education sectors and to see how we can assist them in delivering as they do, not just for young people, but learners of all ages.
Can I ask you, thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for that. But can I ask you what the engagement, what's planned for the college and university sectors then between now and May, just to establish how you can make sure that this funding, whatever it may be, can be used most effectively?
Well, that's really where the Funding Council has an exceptionally important role to play. So they will be engaging with the sector to allocate the funding to the institutions and very, very importantly, to continue to discuss with colleges and universities aspects around long-term financial sustainability, for example, around long-term financial forecasts and so on. So there's an absolutely integral role for the Funding Council to be able to play in this part as we move to the institutional settlements that will come from this, but clearly Scottish Government, my officials and I will keep in close contact with the Funding Council as they continue to make their decisions on this, and particularly also as we move to wider discussions on the spending review for future years.
Okay. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Bob Doris.
Thank you, Convener. On a similar line of questioning, and I don't doubt the financial challenges that Scottish Government has in setting its budget, Convener, but Cabinet Secretary, Colleges Scotland would say they've got a 2.6% real terms cut to their revenue budget, and 38% of school leavers in Scotland from SIMD20 cohorts go to Scotland's colleges. Has the Scottish Government had discussions with Colleges Scotland or made any assessment about the impact of what Colleges Scotland tell us are a 2.6% real terms cut?
So I do appreciate that the college sector expressed disappointment over the settlement that it's been in. I would say this has been an exceptionally challenging process. I think I laid some of this out in the very first part of my introductory statements. And I think that the challenge for a government as we have moved through this is to be able to deliver a fair settlement, but that was obviously allowing us to, as a government as a whole, to be able to deliver on the multiple priorities that we have. So we have supported the college sector, and in the financial year coming forward, their budget has been maintained. And again, I appreciate that has been a difficult settlement for colleges, but certainly the Funding Council, as I just said to Mr. Dornan, will now work very closely with the sector in terms of the institutional settlements that will flow from that to see how we can best deliver for the sector, and what I would you know, readily say is a very, very difficult and challenging year.
That's helpful, Cabinet Secretary, and I think that was a very frank and realistic answer in what will be a challenging budget for Scotland's colleges. So I would ask just how you monitor in the academic year going forward what that impact will be in colleges, because of course during any financial year, Barnett consequentials become available and other spending can be leveraged in by government, and Scotland's colleges will rightly be looking to see how they can get some respite financially in relation to some of that money being leveraged in. If I can give some examples of that, Convener, I'm not sure if the £10 million that colleges, I think, spent under the Young Persons Guarantee in the last financial year is included in that core budget for colleges that I mentioned was challenging, or the £20 million from the Flexible Workforce Development Fund, which I believe was spent in colleges in the last financial year. I suppose, Convener, what I'm trying to get at is we're looking at a budget that's challenging, but will there additional monies be invested in colleges that perhaps we're not seeing in this core budget? And what can colleges expect in relation to that going forward to allow them to plan ahead? Mr Dornan's already spoken about multi-year budgets would certainly help with that forward planning, but can the Cabinet give any reassurances that we're coming back for colleges and what is a specifically financially challenging period going forward?
Well, there is, of course, areas of the budgets of different portfolios which impact on education and skills. And yes, Mr. Norris, there are aspects which are in the finance and economy portfolio budgets that will have an impact also on the investment of colleges. So I would give the Young Persons Guarantee as an example of something which doesn't sit within my budget portfolio, although the policy responsibility does, and that is something which we are continuing to work through how the final allocation for the Young Persons Guarantee will be determined and what that will be. But the overall point around the fact that it's not just the education and skills portfolio which has an impact on colleges is a fair one.
Finally, Convener, can I just ask whether the Cabinet
Secretary... Very briefly, Bob.
Yeah, OK. For once, this will be brief. Would it be possible at some point to get the full quantum of spending in colleges reported in the one place, so this committee doesn't have to look at this committee's budget scrutiny and other committees' budget scrutiny, so we can get a global figure for the money spent in colleges in the coming financial year?
I'm certainly happy to take this away and to see what can be done. It is one of the challenges when we look at education. A lot of the education budget sits within the local government budget, and there are other parts of other government portfolios, I suppose most obviously the finance and economy, that will impact on particularly the skills area. So I'm happy to report back to committee on that and to point in the direction of that spend, if that would be helpful, Convener.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Bob and Bob Dawson. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I just think it's fair to say that the that Alistair Sim from University of Scotland and Shona Struthers from College Scotland wrote to the committee in a letter dated the 21st of December, in which they say, and I think it would be important to get your response to this on the record, because these are clearly two people that are representing their sectors and they are gravely concerned. I'll give you some quotes from their letter. The settlement will translate into a real terms cut to funding for both sectors. The real terms cut in the 2022-23 budget settlement for further higher education is part, and this is quite damning, and I think it's important to get your response to it, is part of an established overall pattern of a lack of investment. Universities and colleges which have been put under pressure are students, staff and infrastructure. They're saying this is an established overall pattern from the Scottish Government. And then they go on to say, however, the outcome of the 2022-23 budget sends the deeply unfortunate signal that the Scottish Government does not fully recognise the role that colleges and universities play in the critical delivery of education, skills and research, which absolutely support economic recovery and transformation. In that context, we are very concerned of the prospects for colleges and universities in the multi-year settlements which the Cabinet Secretary for Finance is expected to deliver in May 22. I think it's important we get your reaction to those very pointed comments on the record.
Well, as I said earlier, I do appreciate that universities and colleges have expressed their disappointment for the settlement for both of those sectors. I would point out the fact that this has been a difficult budget for the reasons I set out in my introductory remarks. We have spent the money that we have been allocated this year as a government. We have had to make difficult choices from that. I do absolutely fully appreciate the role that colleges and universities have played and will continue to play, particularly in our recovery from COVID. The fact that there are no consequentials arising from COVID coming to the Scottish Government has presented the government with challenges in these areas. We do appreciate that, but we have,
Secretary, they say there is an established overall pattern of a lack of investment. That's not one year's money, is it?
Well, we're allocating nearly £2 billion to Scotland's universities and colleges within this budget. I think that is a fair settlement in a challenging area. I think we have provided fair settlements again in the past. So I do appreciate that there are challenges that have been seen, but I would point to the fact, for example, between 2007 and 2021, the college sector resource budget has increased by over 30% in cash terms. Well, so I would give that as an example of where we can, we have, and we will continue to invest in the college and university sector. And we will continue to look at this very closely at the spending review.
I'm sure University of Scotland and College Scotland will be anxious to continue their discussion with you on the basis of their concerns and your response, which I'm not sure, frankly, will have given them much comfort. And with that, I turn to Willie Rennie.
I have to say I'm quite surprised by the Cabinet Secretary's evidence this morning. I don't think she's given any acknowledgement at all to the fact that poor school budgets will be cut by £100 million in this year's settlement. Why is she not spitting mad about this? Surely it's her responsibility to stand up for school budgets.
Well, I would point to the fact that actually we have delivered a very, very strong budget for education and skills. We have seen investments.
£100 million cut.
We have seen.
Why is there no acknowledgement of that at all?
Well, we've seen a very, very important development in our in investment in teachers, for example. But if Mr. Rennie would like to point to that £100 million.
It's quite simple. The real terms cut to councils is £268 million. Education is about half of what councils do. So I'm being actually quite cautious. It's around about a £100 million cut. There's no reference, no acknowledgement. Why is she not spitting mad about this? Surely she shouldn't be defending this cut to the core school budget. She should be arguing for an increase to it. I mean, we heard from Michael Mara, who made some pretty clear points about the challenges, which you acknowledged that pupils and teachers are facing in schools, but yet you impose a £100 million cut to their core budget.
Well, with the greatest respect to Willie Rennie, I don't recognise or accept the figures that he is using on this. The 22-23 local government settlement is £12.5 billion. I think that's fair in the most challenging of circumstances. The figures that have been pointed to about cuts, I think, have been selective and misleading, particularly not taking account of the complete funding that goes in to local government. But what I would point to in terms of education is that the IFS have calculated that school spending per pupil in Scotland is higher in Scotland than it is in England, and that we have provided extra resources to local councils. And 2019-20 was the fifth year in a row that local authority education expenditure saw a real terms increase. So, with the greatest respect to Mr Rennie, I do not accept the premise of the start of his question.
With respect, your answer is rubbish, because we've seen quite clearly from Spice, they've made it clear there's a £268 million cut to local authority budgets. Education is half of what they do. Now, you've made various promises that you are funding in terms of extra teachers and other things, and of course you should, because they were your election promises, and you should fund those. But that doesn't entitle you to cut £100 million from their core budget. And this is not about England, this is about Scotland. I don't want the comparisons with elsewhere, because I care about the pupils in Scotland. So why on earth is she not angry about this? I mean, I'm angry. I can't believe that you're cutting budgets at this time. But so why are you not angry about it? That's what I don't understand with this. It's very managerial.
Well, I think, with the greatest respect to Mr Rennie, I don't accept the premise of the figures that you're using.
This is from Spice Cabinet Secretary. I'm sure your own briefing, if you dig into it, you will discover there's a £268 million cut. Now, councillors right across the board, including SNP councillors, they're spitting mad about the local authority settlement. What I can't understand is why you're not, when education is a massive part of what local authorities do. Why are you not angry?
And absolutely, the settlement that's been provided will deliver a real terms growth in the overall settlement. It has the protection for core budgets in cash terms. It will allow the additional funding to go in for teachers and support staff. It contains the funding for the 100 days commitments, some of which I mentioned in my introductory remarks. It contains the funding for the free school meals settlements also. And I would put it to Mr Rennie, if he wishes to see more money going into local government or elsewhere, I'm sure he will tell me or perhaps Ms Forbes later on in the budget process where that money should be cut from to allow that to happen.
Well, I might have to, because it's quite clear that the Cabinet Secretary is not going to make any efforts to argue for more funding for school core budgets. And it's your job to stand up for education, and you're not making that case. Why on earth are you sitting here today complacently accepting the fact that the Cabinet Secretary for Finance is effectively cutting £100 million from your core budget? It's undermining the work that you're doing. Why are you not making the case for this?
I think the government overall has a fair settlement for education and for local government, and absolutely I would encourage Mr Rennie for, I think perhaps the first year, to put forward costed budget alternatives, whether he'd like to take that from health or from justice or from transport or for our work on net zero. The budget has been set out where that money is going. If Mr Rennie wishes to see more money going in, he does have to see where the money will come from, given the budget has been spent in its entirety. Yes, he can demand more action is taken, but he has to suggest where that money will come from if he is not satisfied with the budget proposals that have been forward by the government.
The Cabinet Secretary has swallowed the script this morning. I mean, I think teachers, councillors, the pupils and the parents will listen to the answers from the Cabinet Secretary today, and they will draw one conclusion, that she is not standing up for Scottish education and making the case, because we would not see a £100 million cut to core school budgets if she was making the case. I think I'm finished, Cabinet Secretary and convener.
Thank you, Willie Rennie. I'm going to ask in James Dornan, who has a supplementary question to put to the Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Convener. I'll be very brief. Hey, Cabinet Secretary, you've kind of answered the question I was going to ask, because the reality is here that Mr Kerr, Mr Mara, Mr Rennie have all asked for extra money. Surely your role is to argue for as much as you can within the budget process, within Cabinet, and at that stage then the Scottish Government have to say, this is the money we've got, this is how we're going to spend it. If you want to spend it in any other way, you please tell us whereabouts from the budget you're going to get that money. And there's been no sign of that from any of the three speakers previous.
Well, thank you.
I'm asking for a response from the Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, I'm about to turn it over to the Cabinet Secretary. Although, yeah, OK, carry on. Yes.
Thank you.
I'll be brief, Convener. I mean, I think this is an unfortunate part of the usual budget process that we go through from many of the opposition parties, where there are demands for additional expenditure, not just within my portfolio, but in other government portfolios as well, from all opposition parties, where they can absolutely come to committees such as this and demand additional spending per portfolio. None of it then comes into an actual budget alternative, where there's serious discussions with the Finance Secretary about the alternatives to the budget that has been proposed. It is very easy to come forward and demand more money is spent on something. Okay. It is much more difficult to have a budget settlement.
I think we'll move on. I'm going to ask in Fergus Ewing now. Thank you, Fergus.
Yes, thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I very much welcome the additional investment which will allow in Scotland local authorities and schools to see the additional numbers of teachers provided. And I wanted to ask the Cabinet Secretary about two areas. Firstly, the additional costs of meeting education provision in rural parts of Scotland, especially in the Highland Council area, which, as the Cabinet Secretary knows, has 29 high schools and 204 schools in all, the largest number in Scotland. And of course, a great number of those, particularly primary schools, have very small rolls, which means that per pupil, if you like, the number of teachers that Highland Council must employ will be greater than the average in other urban council areas. In addition to that, the extra transport costs, the higher costs of building work, whether it's new build or repairs, are, I think, a recognised fact. And the last particular point I'd just like to bring to the Cabinet Secretary's attention is that my information from close discussion with senior officials in Highland Council is that the level of these extra costs has been exacerbated as a result of restrictions in the construction sector, restricted capacity and lesser competition. So I know that, Cabinet Secretary, that the funding formula in local government does try to reflect rurality, but she is aware that this committee has raised this issue with her already in this section of Parliament. And I just wondered if she could perhaps outline for myself and other members representing a rural or largely rural constituencies, how we can be sure that rural authorities have sufficient resource under the formula, and whether she thinks there is a scope now and a need to revisit the details of the formula to make sure that this important factor of rurality in terms of costs of providing education provision is properly provided for. Thank you.
So I recognise this is an area that Mr Ewing has a very long-standing interest in, obviously given his constituency interest. So there are, I think, probably two different areas I would point to on this. One is what we can do from Scottish Government funding out with the local government settlement to be able to take better account of rurality. So I would point to the changes we've made to the Scottish Attainment Challenge funding, which now will allocate funding for all 32 local authorities, recognising that there is poverty in all areas. As we've looked at how we distribute money, what we've also looked to do is, as has been pointed out by Audit Scotland in the past, SIMD, for example, isn't a particularly useful measurement for rural areas. So we are keen to look at, for example, the use of free school meals or the children in low-income families data, which again allows us a much better analysis of rurality in different areas. So we are challenging ourselves within government to see how we can change government funding streams to better take account of that. As he also, of course, points to, though, the local authority funding is agreed by a settlement, which is based on a formula agreed with COSLA. What I would say, I suppose, is that the government is always open to evidence-based suggestions to improve that funding formula, but I would absolutely want to stress to committee that fundamental changes to that would, of course, have to properly come through COSLA in the first instance. But if Mr Ewing has concerns about that, I would be, of course, very happy to hear about more than that in further detail. That evidence-based approach is, I think, the right way to go about this, because we quite rightly have to work with our partners in local government over the wider aspects which are out with the control just of Scottish Government. I hope that's given them some reassurance about what is in our power, what we have looked to do to make sure that rurality is taken account of.
Well, I am very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for that comprehensive answer, and in particular the inclusion of the Highland Council and other areas in the attainment funding, because, as he rightly says, poverty is no stranger to several parts of the Highlands and indeed in my own constituency. So I'm pleased that that is recognised by the Scottish Government. That is a step forward, and I will relay her comments to senior officials in the Highland Council, with whom I'm in touch later today, as it happens. The other area I wanted to ask the Cabinet Secretary was how in our secondary schools provision is made to assist those pupils who have mental health issues, recognising, of course, the Cabinet Secretary, that the prime responsibility will rest with the NHS, but mindful of the fact that very often, according to information I have, from my own constituency work, early intervention by specific allocated staff at schools designed to assist teenagers who are undergoing various forms of mental ill health can play a really important part. After all, many adolescents, many teenagers are slow to trust people and to take advice, to build up a relationship with someone in whom they have confidence, to help them through difficulties, which may include Asperger's, autism, anorexia, self-harm, and other very, very serious matters where some adolescents really have problems. So just recently I have had a harrowing constituency case, the details of which I won't go into here, but I do feel that this is a provision that is available in some of the schools in my constituency, and I would stress that the standard of assistance for those who need it is very high and very much appreciated, but just too limited in its scope. One head teacher said that he could do with three times as many teachers as he has dealing with this particular area, which is, of course, so important to help young people who are troubled for one reason or another. And I appreciate that in asking this question, I'm sorry it's somewhat longer than I had intended, but I appreciate it's not the prime responsibility of you, Cabinet Secretary, but tackling mental health is something that requires collaboration across schools, health, social services and other areas of public and life, and indeed the third sector. So I wonder how we can make sure that every school is able to provide a sufficient level of support in this area, and what reporting mechanisms exist, for example, for head teachers to report to local authorities, education directors and so on. I'm not familiar with this particular world. Do we need to do more to make sure that there is a reporting of outcomes to local authorities, for example, so that accountability exists in every one of the 32 local authorities? Thank you.
So this is a very serious issue, and it's something that the government takes very seriously. Yes, the much of the responsibility will be through CAMHS, but I would point to, I think, two examples of how education can assist in these areas. One would be the funding that we have given to local government to allow for a counsellor in every secondary school. And this is quite a new initiative, so we are monitoring very closely the demand on that service right across the country to see how needs are being met and so on. So it's quite a reasonably still new initiative, but available, and I think an important addition to what's going on. The other aspect I would point to, which is a development which we are putting the additional funding into next year's budget, but will increase over the parliamentary session, is around the whole family wellbeing funding. So there's £50 million going in across government onto the whole family wellbeing fund. And that is very important, that we look at that the challenges that a young person or a family will face in a very holistic manner. So it could include aspects around child poverty or educational attainment, but it could very much, of course, include aspects around mental health and substance abuse as well. So our development of that whole family wellbeing fund is, I think, another very important step to ensure that we are supporting families and using educational establishments to be a source of where people can be reassured that that support will be available, and there's no, you know, there's no wrong door to this. If a family needs support, the intention of this whole family wellbeing fund is to ensure that that happens, and mental health will absolutely play an important part in that.
Well, I'm very pleased to hear of the recent development of a counsellor in every school, secondary school presumably. So that sounds an extremely welcome a development, and I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for the answer, and I hope that this is, I expect it will be a matter that she will keep under close review and in her work with her Cabinet colleagues. Thank you.
Thank you, Fergus. A quick supplementary from Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you. Just following on from Fergus mentioning children and young people with additional support needs there, including neurodiversity. In the Morgan report as well, we heard that, you know, quite often and other evidence that the focus actually ends up on children and young people who are presenting with challenging behaviour, and that sometimes that's really at the expense of the other children in the class who may also have additional support needs but maybe are not particularly present with those behaviours. And I was just wondering if you could offer any reassurance around the fact that that's going to be addressed going forward.
Well, certainly all teachers provide significant support to pupils with additional support needs, as do the specialist support learning staff that we have. The budget that we are discussing today continues to provide that additional support to local authorities for investing £15 million every year to enhance the capacity to respond effectively to individual needs. Clearly, how that money is utilised can be, for example, through additional pupil support assistance and whatnot. The overall responsibility, of course, for every young person lies with their school to be able to provide sufficient support. But we are jointly with COSLA implementing the ASL review outcomes, and we have seen some of that work impacted by COVID, but we are keen to move forward with a revised action plan, and hopefully the revised action plan will deal with some of the issues which you've raised there.
Thanks very much.
And a supplementary from Oliver Mundell, and then we'll stay with Oliver for his questions to Cabinet Secretary. Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, in relation to Fergus Ewing's question around rural funding, you mentioned the change to using low-income families as a measure for the attainment funding. Will the same consideration be given to extending it to pupil equity funding? I've raised it before, but I'm concerned about a small number of what are predominantly smaller rural schools who don't get any pupil equity funding at all.
So, from memory, I think it's 97% of schools receive pupil to equity funding. We haven't actually published the allocations to each school on pupil to equity funding as yet. We will seek to do that in due course. So Mr. Mundell will be able to see at that point what the allocations are to it. But the use of free school meals as a proxy has been used as well. And of course that will be as relevant, I would hope, to a small rural school as that would be to larger areas, as it's based on the, you know, the number of children that are presenting for free school meals.
Well, I frankly find that answer very, very disappointing, because it's well established that there's often stigma attached to being poor in rural communities, where that poverty is, you know, much more visible often, and you know, I think that's recognised by various poverty campaigners. So I'm sad to hear you say that you think school meal uptake is the same in rural areas, because many people don't think that's the case. However, I don't want to take up all my questioning time with a supplementary. I was going to ask Cabinet Secretary how much additional money has been allocated in the budget to guarantee this year's exams will take place.
So there doesn't require to be any changes to the budget to ensure that exams will take place. The absolute central planning assumption of the SQA is that exams will take place. That's the planning that's moving forward, and therefore the budget that's set out for the SQA is on that basis.
Again, I think people will find that answer strange, particularly those in education who would expect you'd be pulling out all the stops this year after the disruption we've seen in the last 2 years. Measures that have been suggested to me include acquiring additional community spaces to allow for greater social distancing, should that be required at the time, taking on more invigilators, and of course putting in place one-to-one catch-up support and tutoring for those young people who've missed out on a considerable amount of learning. Surely, you know, that would seem sensible, and surely just telling them that what the questions are going to be isn't a substitute for what they've missed out on.
Well, I answered Mr. Mundell's original question based on what it takes to deliver exams. The delivery of exams is what I answered that on. The exams will take place unless at the time during the exam diet there is
the answer is zero additional resources going to support schools in exams actually taking place. The answer is £0.
Well, if you'd let me answer the question, Mr. Mundell, you might actually hear what I'm about to say. the only reason that exams will not take place is because there's public health guidance around the prevention of gatherings. So clearly, if that happens, then I think it would be irresponsible for the government to say exams should take place if there's public health advice saying gatherings shouldn't happen. Now, what clearly the SQA is continuing to work on is an insurance that exams can take place safely, and they will continue to do that. Within the wider educational settlement, there is clearly a great deal of work that's ongoing around what support can be given while learning is disrupted. So there is a wider pool of material in terms of the e-learning offer, increasing study support sessions, etc. So there is a great deal, not within the budget that we are looking at this point, because clearly we need to be delivering that now. So this year, this calendar year, there is increased support that's gone in to the e-learning offer that will look at that. What we're also very closely working with local government colleagues on is around what they are already putting in place for Easter revision and whether there's further support that can be made to that. Now, the reason why I've not made an announcement on that to date is because we need to know what the local authorities will be doing to make sure that what we are doing is in addition to what already happens. But there is a great deal of work that's already ongoing to ensure that young people are being supported while their learning is being disrupted at this time.
Yeah, all this sounds like too little, too late. I tweet about some parts of the exam process, but holding back other information that parents, teachers, students, teachers and young people are looking for. And I think people will judge that for themselves.
Well, can I say, Mr. Mandel, I'm not holding back any information on
this. You've literally just told us that you're looking at additional support for pupils to help them catch up on lost learning, but you're not going to tell us the detail of that right now. It's a joint endeavour, education, between local councils and the Scottish Government, and these discussions shouldn't be taking place behind closed doors. You should be providing that information to parents, pupils and teachers now so that they can set aside time, possibly in their Easter break, to make the most of those provisions.
And we will be providing information as soon as we can about what is happening at a national level. I'm sure at a local level there is already work ongoing with schools and local authorities. I don't think anyone wants to be in a position where young people are concerned about the build-up to their exams or to their learning. And that's why I think it is very important to reassure them that throughout this entire academic year, there has been continuous work that's been ongoing to ensure that through eSchool and through other e-learning opportunities, that work has continued to be built on. It will continue to be built on during this year. It is the feedback we've had is that it's going down exceptionally well, and it's being well received by teachers and pupils. So there has been an exceptional amount of work during this entire academic year to build on what's available to support children and young people, and we will continue to do so.
Well, I mean, I think I don't want to be rude, but I think you need to get real. Young people, parents and teachers are anxious now. They're expressing concern. They feel they've missed out on education. They feel it's not clear. There's not clear messaging coming from the government around what's going to happen with exams. You're saying that there are plans in the background for additional catch-up, but we don't know anything about them or what they'd actually involve in detail. There's zero, from your answer, zero additional pounds going in to facilitate exams actually taking place and putting sensible precautions in place. It just seems like a repeat of what we've seen of the last 2 years, where exams and education are not really a priority. But I wanted to ask as well, as a final question, what additional resource and support is going in to help teachers take part in the education reform process. Clearly, they have been pulling out all the stops to keep our young people in classrooms. They're doing the very best they can in difficult circumstances. But what additional resource are you putting in place to free them up to actually participate meaningfully in that process?
So Ken Muir has now completed his consultation on the work. So this again is in this financial year, not next financial year. He's completed his consultation process on this work. The consultation was exceptionally well received by frontline staff and by stakeholders, and was very, very heavily used within that. On top of that, we have, of course, had discussions within the Scottish Education Council, within the teachers panel, to ensure that there is maximum consultation and discussion that's going on. Ken Muir will now report back to me. It's due by the end of this month, and I will then, as quickly as I can, but obviously his recommendations, I think, will cover a lot of ground, quickly as I can report back in that. And with after that process has happened and I report back on the government's response to Ken Muir, we will absolutely make sure that the work that is ongoing from that has a very, very key role for, I would say, the staff of both agencies that are involved in the reform process, but also to ensure that staff themselves will play a role in that. Now, what that will be, it will be difficult to determine at this point because Mr Muir hasn't responded back at this point. But I have given my reassurance to stakeholders that I'm absolutely determined to have a very, very empowered reform process where frontline staff and importantly, pupils themselves have a key role in that process, and I think that is adequately accounted for in the budget that we have in front of us.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Oral Mandel. I'm going to first go back to Bob Doris. I know we've heard a couple of times from Bob. Just want to make sure that he, if he has any further contribution he wishes to make to this evidence session.
I don't think so, Convener. I think there's quite a lot for us to digest in private as a committee and maybe take forward on that basis. But thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. There are a couple of colleagues who wish to come back in with supplementaries. I'm going to first go to Michael Mara. Michael?
Thanks, Convener. I was just waiting for the camera to go back on. Thanks for letting me back in, and apologies to colleagues for raising they know my obsession with ventilation issues. The Cabinet Secretary and I have exchanged letters and many comments in the Chamber on this. I was very welcoming of the announcement yesterday that limited resource for active ventilation in schools. Prior to Christmas, the Cabinet Secretary was very strident in her rejection of any idea of active ventilation. So I wonder whether she could tell us at what point over the Christmas period did the government change its mind, and of the £5 million, how many air purifying devices does she think that can provide for Scotland schools?
It remains as it was before Christmas. The guidance is based on the expert advice which government receives.
Sorry, Cabinet Secretary, we're not hearing you.
If the convener could tell me if anyone else can hear me, because I can certainly.
Yeah, I think I can hear you. So,
right, okay.
Maybe,
yeah.
Sorry, Mr. Mara can come back if he can't hear me in correspondence. I'm sure he will, but I'll carry on at this point and see where we get to. So I think I said that the guidance hadn't changed from before Christmas. We listened very carefully to the expert advice that we have on this area. The £5 million is, of course, in addition to the £10 million that was given previously for CO2 monitoring, and of course the previous allocation for £90 million for COVID logistics, which many local authorities used part of that for improved ventilation. So in terms of the ventilation fund, support fund that was announced by the First Minister yesterday, That's to ensure that we are supporting the Scottish guidance. That is, as I said, the same as it was before Christmas on ventilation in schools. It will help support any remedial action that's required. As I've said to Mr Mara and others in the past, there is, from the feedback we're getting from local authorities, a very small amount of remedial action that has been required for a small minority of spaces. But what I wanted to ensure is that funding was not a blockage to this, hence the reason for this. So, of course, this fund could be used for funding for HEPA filters if they were identified as the only appropriate solution for particular spaces. But I would point out once again the expert advice that we are getting in on this issue is that air cleaning devices should not be used as an alternative to improving natural ventilation. And it makes very, very clear in the updated guidance the circumstances in which the use of air cleaning and filtration devices may be appropriate, and that's aligned with the advice we're getting from the Health and Safety Executive. So this money is not simply for HEPA filters, it is for what the remedial action local authorities feel is required, and they can then discuss that with Scottish Government colleagues.
So contrary to what the First Minister announced yesterday, this is not funding for active ventilation in schools. It's just an additional £5 million put on top of the previous monies that have been allocated that the Cabinet Secretary has said have resulted in very limited action. So I mean that to me is very disappointing, and frankly, Cabinet Secretary, very contrary to what the First Minister said yesterday. So if it's on that, I mean, we put forward a motion in December that the SNP and Green colleagues voted against, that would have set out £30 million in total that could have procured 2 HEPA filters for each classroom in Scotland. I mean, is that not the kind of action that should be taken now? We're talking about the budget today. Should the Cabinet Secretary not actually just recognise, listen to the First Minister, frankly, when she's saying in the chamber that this should happen, and actually argue for £30 million to be put in place in the budget to actually procure these filters?
With the greatest respect, Mr Mara, the action that has been taken by local authorities is what local authorities have deemed necessary to deal with the challenges. So there's been limited action because local authorities have been reassured that what is in place is adequate for what needs to happen. I am not aware of any local authority that has been held back in any action because of a limitation in funds. I can assure Mr Mara, I listen very carefully to what the First Minister says at all times. She and I are on absolutely the same page on this, because there is a recognition that this money can be used for air filters, but of course this is within the use of guidance. As with all our reactions to COVID, policy must be based on expert advice. And again, with the greatest respect to Mr Mara, the expert advice, including what comes from SAGE, including what comes from Health and Safety Executive, it would not lead and suggest to the policy that he wishes to put in place. It simply does not equate to what the expert advice actually says it needs to happen. So what we have done as a government is ensure that what we have is an opportunity for local authorities to be able to move forward with remedial action, absolutely, if it's required, for HEPA air cleaning filters to be used. And that is very, very important that that is there. It's already within the guidance that that can happen. There's nothing stopping that happening at that point, if that's what's deemed that local authorities wish to happen. The other aspect I'm very, very keen to ensure that we take on is the concerns which Mr Mara raised, a concern before Christmas, which I encouraged him to ensure had been taken up through official channels. But I have, in conjunction with my COSLA colleague, Councillor McCabe, written out to all local authorities, written out to all unions on this issue, to say that we have a workforce issues group where we continuously ask for specifics where we can, within whether Scottish Government or local authorities, act on specific concerns that teachers have. We have not had any specific concerns that we need to look at, but we have absolutely once again written out to all unions to ask them for not a general concern, but if there are specific concerns from specific teachers, which we can of course deal with in confidence, if required, that we take that very, very seriously, and we have reached out to ensure that that can happen.
Camina, I think we've reached a bit of an impasse here. I mean, the distance from the reality that teachers and pupils are facing on the ground in this response is quite astonishing. If I can, the Cabinet Secretary references a case I raised with her in the Chamber, where she told me to ask a teacher to raise it with their union rep. That teacher is the union rep in the school. Okay, so these people are not finding any recourse in terms of the kind of action that they need for active ventilation. But it's quite clear what we're hearing now is that the fund put in place can't even be ring fenced to be spent on that. So I mean, I'm at my wit's end with this, frankly. With
well, Mr. Mara,
thanks for being on that subject.
Mr. Mara, the funds can be spent in any way that a local authority thinks it is required to be spent on. I think it's important that we give the ultimate flexibility to local authorities to allow that to happen. And I certainly hope that local authorities will take up that flexibility and use that flexibility in any way that they require to be able to meet the guidance that is based on expert advice. And we will take up any issue of individual concerns exceptionally seriously.
How much are these units typically costing? How much do they typically cost, these units?
The typical cost for a HEPA filter is, I think, not something which is in my pack at the moment. It was something which we've clearly looked at when we were analysing the £5 million fund. So I can certainly get that very easily to committee, but I don't have that.
I think the rationale for how you arrived at the 10 and the 5 in terms of, again, I come back to the theme that I started off the meeting with, and that is in terms of outcomes. It would be quite interesting to know what the rationale is. Are they £500? Are they 1,000? Are they 5,000? I think it would be quite interesting to see what the working out is. You know, when we were all at school, we were told to show our working out. So I'd like to see the working out that the government put into coming up with these numbers. Would you be agreeable to sending us that information as a committee?
Absolutely. I mean, we can certainly look to do that. It's the £10 million was obviously there for CO2 monitoring, so was based on the cost of delivery of CO2 monitoring. But for the level of funding required for the £5 million, that isn't based on the fact that we think that we have an ask from local authorities for £5 million at this point. That was our attempt to make sure that we are able to meet the needs of local authorities as it comes forward.
There was a rationale to the £5 million, I take it. It wasn't just a number plucked out of the thin air.
Certainly money is far too tight to pluck money to pluck figures out of the air. So we can certainly provide that and the cost of the HEPA filter to committee.
Yeah, it would seem a bit ironic to pluck a number out of thin air for an air filter, but there you go. That's my joke for the morning. I'm going to go to Ross Greer, who indicates he wished to come back in. He said earlier he did as well. Ross.
Thanks, Convener. And yes, it's on this point still with filtration. In the first instance, I would just make the point that based at least on the EIS members survey that was completed and published recently, there's not a need to put two HEPA filters in every single classroom in Scotland. There are thousands of classrooms where the data is showing us and where teachers are telling us that there is sufficient airflow and ventilation is fine. That being said, that's far from every classroom. That's why this money is being provided. So I've got a couple of questions about how the money is being deployed. And just in the first instance, could the Cabinet Secretary clarify, because this is a budget scrutiny session, is the aim to deploy all this money in the current financial year, i.e. in the next 6 weeks, or does the government reckon that this will spill into the next financial year from 1st of April?
Well, we're working very, very quickly with local authorities to be able to determine how to get this money out the door as quickly as possible. If there's a wish there to have funding provided, then we want to be able to provide it in this financial year.
Thanks. And is the aim in terms of that distribution model, is the aim to come up with a formula for dividing between the 32 local authorities, or will it be on the basis of authorities essentially making a bid for what they believe is necessary in their area, how much that would cost, the difference it would make, i.e. it's a pot they can draw down from rather than 5 million that is distributed between 32 different bodies all at once?
Well, it ties into to the point that you raised yourself there about the need for this will be different in different local authority areas. It may vary depending on, for example, the age of the schools and what's in place already within different schools setting. So it would seem more sensible for that to be drawn down as required by local authorities, so that we can ensure that we're getting the money to where it is required, because as Mr Greer rightly points out, the material that came out from the EIS survey, but I would point to the feedback we are receiving from local authorities as well, from the CO2 monitoring, is that there has been very little remedial action that's been required at this point. So we want to be able to direct this £5 million funding to where it's needed.
Thanks. And just finally, you mentioned a letter that was sent in the name of yourself and Councillor Stephen McCabe to unions. Actually, that was forwarded to me this morning by a union that I've been working with on this issue. And they certainly welcomed the opportunity to give those specific examples, because I understand there has been this disconnect between the anecdotal examples that we're all hearing and the specifics actually reaching the issues group that are able to then resolve them. Can I just check, as well as being sent to unions, will that letter, will that offer also be made openly to individual teachers, but also to teachers who are organising, as well as through their unions, through other groups as well? I'm aware that a lot of the issues around ventilation have been spearheaded by a grassroots group of teachers who were featured on STV, BBC News in the last couple of days. I'm sure they would be very keen to contribute as a group. Most of them are actually union reps themselves, and I'm sure we'll do it through that avenue. But are we maximising the number of ways that teachers and other school staff are able to flag up specific issues that are, for whatever reason, not being resolved at school or local authority level?
Well, we're certainly certainly can't speak on behalf of Councillor McCabe, but I think on the overall issue, we are in joint agreement between local and national government that we want to do anything that's required to be able to assist in this. So, of course, we would take information from other sources if that was at all possible. I would point to the fact, though, that we have got the Workforce Issues Group that's chaired by COSLA, which looks at many issues, but particularly ventilation, where unions sit there, there are Scottish Government officials chaired by COSLA, and unions are asked for specific examples that are not being dealt with locally. That can be, in effect, escalated if it needs to be dealt with in another way. That hasn't proved fruitful. We haven't had material coming through, hence the reason why I've taken the decision to write out directly to once again appeal to unions, but certainly happy to take that information from elsewhere, that if there are particular concerns in areas, then that avenue is open in the Workforce Issues Group. It is the place where that can be looked at in great detail.
Thanks. I've had probably about a dozen specific issues raised with me that I'm happy to go back and confirm with those teachers that they're happy to have them passed on to the Working Issues Group. If that's the case, hopefully I'll have that with you by the end of the week. That's all from me, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you, Ross Greer. And a supplementary from Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, Convener. I see my microphone's just come on. Cabinet Secretary, there's certainly been some challenging questions around education budget today for you. Not always the most polite, sadly. Can you maybe comment on the importance of the wider policies as well, such as the Scottish Child Payment that are out with education itself, that really are critical for addressing the poverty-related attainment gap in the longer term? Particularly with the UK government reducing universal credit at the moment. And perhaps as well, it would be helpful to maybe have some reassurance from you that you will be arguing passionately that these wider policies that impact educational achievement will be prioritised at cabinet level and beyond. Thanks.
Well, that's not a supplementary, but if you would very briefly seek to answer that, Shirley Ann Somerville, thank you.
Briefly, I think the point is a very, very valid one, is that there are many impacts on education from other parts of Scottish Government expenditure. The poverty-related attainment gap obviously is a key concern for government to be able to close that. One of the aspects that we also need to do is just tackle child poverty at its source, and the Scottish Child Payment, which Stephanie Callaghan mentioned, is an example of that. There's very close working that's happening between education and child poverty officials, for example, in Ms Robertson's portfolio, to be able to ensure that we are very, very collegiately working together on child poverty and education. So I would give that as one example of how the importance of other parts of government impact on education.
Thank you so much. And one last question from me, and that is, you mentioned the Muir report, you mentioned some timelines earlier, but can I ask if the committee will receive a copy of the report as before the Scottish Government makes its response to it?
So I'm not yet aware of when exactly Ken Muir will report back. He's obviously finalising that, and it's within his gift. We certainly expect that to be by the end of the year, and then we'll look to publish his report in due course after that as well. So obviously at that point, committee would be made aware of that.
Thank you. We clearly would like to have a look at the report as soon as we possibly can, as I'm sure you feel exactly the same way. Cabinet Secretary, can I thank you and your officials for your time today? It has been a very useful and revealing session, typically robust, but all well within order. And we look forward to the next occasion that you and officials will join us in our committee meeting. The public part of today's meeting is now an end, and I will now suspend the meeting. Can I ask members to reconvene on Microsoft Teams, and this will allow us to consider our final agenda item in private. Thank you, and good morning.